Good morning, good morning, good morning. This is Elder Michael Stibick at Higher Ground Temple, Amen, 203 Vine Street in Camden, New Jersey. Up early and on the phone this morning, Amen. Here it is, it's 7 o'clock in the morning, but it's never too early for a word from God. It's never too early to work on the relationship with God. Hopefully, if you're already up, hopefully you've already even said some prayers. Hopefully you've had a little chat with God already. If nothing else, hopefully at least when you woke up this morning, and here's someone who I'm sure already did what I'm about to say, but if you're up this morning, hopefully if nothing else, you've already said, thank you, God, for waking me up today. Thank you, God, for giving me another day to try to get it right, because it is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice, and we shall be glad in it. Not we might be, not we should be, but we will be. Why? Because we know how we are blessed. There she is. Dari Baker Connor, good to see you on this morning. And my lovely wife, Jerry, as always, amen. She's up helping me get ready, especially on these days. I'm telling you, when you get up a little bit earlier and it's staying dark a little bit later, sometimes it's a little bit harder to get out of bed early in the morning. For me, anyway, I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about me. So I thank my wife that she's here to help get me up and get me ready. I see Patricia Phillips coming on this morning. I see the Saints are coming on. We got a lot of early risers. Carl Mahan coming on this morning. It is good to see you, sir. It is good to see you. I love that prayer, man. You prayed on that prayer line yesterday, sir. You prayed on that prayer line. Thank you very much. You got my day off to a good start. I carried that with me the rest of the day. So I thank you, sir, for what you do. So we're here today, though. We're here today to bring you a word. We are here to bring you a word that's going to make a difference in your life, that will hopefully give you a little perspective, amen, on how you walk and on how you talk and on what you do. And if you see here, our title today may be a little bit deceiving. Our title today is That Word Come to Life, amen. And when I actually came up, when the title came to me, I actually first went to John chapter 1, where it says that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God at the beginning, and that nothing was created without the Word, and all that was created through the Word. And then it goes on to talk later on in John chapter 1 about the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, amen. Talking about who? Talking about Jesus, amen. But here's the thing, the title might be a little bit deceiving, because I'm not going to John chapter 1, I'm going somewhere else a little bit different. Because why? Because we are Jesus' disciples. We are Jesus' disciples, which means we're supposed to do what Jesus did. We're supposed to say what Jesus said. So if Jesus is the Word come to life, then we ourselves should be the Word come to life as well. Amen. That we are, amen. We are, as Bishop Barron has said on many occasions, amen. You are the only Bible that most people are going to read. Most people aren't getting up early in the morning and coming on for a Bible study. Most people aren't getting up early in the morning and praying. Most people aren't getting up early in the morning and reading this Word. Amen. People just don't seem to be doing it these days. So what is the Bible they read? The Bible they read is those that they know that have accepted Jesus Christ. Amen. So we've got to take very seriously that we are the Word come to life. Amen. And we're going to look today at what does it mean that we are the Word come to life. We're going to look at how we need to act and what we need to say to be the Word come to life. And we're going to look at what are some of the consequences, amen, when we do it right and when we do it wrong. I see Phyllis Kelly coming on this morning too. I tell you, these saints, man, they like to get up early. Amen. I think I got more people coming on at 7 than when I was on at 8 o'clock. Apparently, I thought at 8 o'clock I was coming on too early. Apparently, I was coming on too late. It's good to see you out there, woman of God. Phyllis Kelly, thank you for all that you do as well. And we're going to be coming today. We're going to be coming today from the book of 2 Corinthians. That's right, we're going to be coming from 2 Corinthians chapter 3, and we're going to look at verses 1 through 4. Amen. That's 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. But before we get into the word for today, and we're talking about that word, that Jesus, that word come to life, amen, that not just Jesus wasn't just called to be the word come to life, but we are called to be the word come to life. And I want to give you a little illustration of what I'm talking about here, what we're going to be talking about here. And where do we spend, it seems like, most of our lives? It seems like we spend most of our lives at work, right? We probably spend more time at work than we do with our families. Amen. I think we got it backwards. Amen. But it's the way that we do it now. We're spending 40 hours a week at work. When you take out sleeping, amen, you're spending probably more time at work than we are even with our family. So I want to give you a little illustration from work about being the word come to life. Amen. And I'm going to give you two examples. There's a woman that used to come into my job all the time. I work at a bank, and she used to come in all the time, and she would come in just using the name Jesus all over the place. Amen. She would come in talking about Jesus, how much she loved Jesus. But then every time she came in, if the wait was too long, she'd be cussing, she'd be complaining, she'd get up to the teller and she'd be nasty to the teller because she had to wait for 3.5 minutes to get her transaction done. If she was short a nickel, she'd be cussing somebody out. But yet every time she came in, she was talking about Jesus. She was talking about how she depended on Jesus. She was talking about how she loved Jesus. And then the way that she acted and the way she treated people was completely against everything that Jesus taught us. And I used to see that woman come in, and the first thing I would always say, I would always pray is God, just let her be a good example today. But without fail, I mean, every time before she walked out of that bank, she was hollering at somebody. She was complaining at somebody. She was making a scene every time. And it got to a point, man, where when she came in, I almost started thinking, man, please don't mention the name Jesus, because if you're going to act that way, we don't want people thinking that that's the way that we should act when we're following Jesus, because we should be doing and saying what Jesus would say and do. Amen. So you've got that one end of the spectrum. Amen. Where what's your letter? What kind of, as Bishop always asks the question, what kind of Bible are you? She was a cussing. She was an ornery. She was a nasty Bible. Anybody who was thinking about following Jesus, it says, if that's where, and if they ask themselves the question, where is it going to lead me? And if they're thinking, if that's where it's going to lead me, nobody would choose, amen, to follow Jesus with the example that she was setting. And yet I want to give you another example from work. I have a person at work, amen, that had a son that was sick. And I'm not talking about the flu. I'm not talking about the sniffles. I'm not talking about little Johnny had a tummy ache, but really life-threatening illness, amen. And this person was coming in, and if you didn't know, if you weren't one to sit and talk to her, you would ever never known by the way she was acting what she was going through. She would reveal it to you back in the back room, because she knows, you know, we're both believers, and she would share things with me. But if you didn't know, if you didn't talk to her, you never would have known, a customer walking in there, what she was going through. And then one day, she's sitting there, she's talking, it got to a point where she was actually concerned she might lose her child, amen, that God might call him home. And you know what she said to me? She's sitting there talking, and she's saying, you know, she said, I was so scared. She said, I was so worried. She said, and I was asking God, don't take him now, don't take him now. But then what she said was this, and I love it. She said, but if you do, she said, who am I to question your will? Amen. Now that is the word come to life right there. Because that's when you can sit there and when you do something and somebody says, man, Jesus did that in the Bible. Jesus said that in the Bible. Because you know what? When she said that, what came to my mind was Jesus in the Garden at Gethsemane. He was saying, God, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. I don't want to get beaten. I don't want to get whipped. I don't want to go through this. I don't want to get spikes driven through my hands. I don't want to have a spear stuck in my side. But your will be done. And when she said that, Man, so clear. She was Jesus sitting right in front of me in the Garden of Gethsemane praying. And that's what we need to do. That's what we need to be, is we need to be Jesus. Amen. Come to life before the people. Amen. Just like that. Just like that person at my job. Amen. We don't need to be the one that's cussing, the one that's making a scene, the one that's being nasty. We need to be the one that when we say something, amen, somebody who knows the word says, you know what? Man, that is, I heard Jesus say that. I saw Jesus do that. That's what we should be striving for in all that we say and do. One of the greatest compliments you can get is when you don't tell somebody you're a Christian and they come up to you and they say, you're a believer, aren't you? When it happens, man, nothing makes me more assured that I am on the right path than when someone who doesn't know me, who just met me, who just observed me for a little bit comes up and says, you're a Christian, aren't you? I love it. It makes my day. So here's where we're coming. We're coming from, again, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. And it says, do we begin again to commend ourselves, or do we need, as some others, epistles or of commendation to you, or letters of commendation from you? Amen. So before Peter, or I'm sorry, before Paul gets to this point in the letter, he's talking about how they are an example. Amen. He's talking about Pamela Vasquez coming along. So before Paul gets to this part, he's talking about how they are life. Amen. They are the aroma of life to those that believe. Amen. To those that are being saved. Amen. And he's saying, But now, when we're that aroma of life, when we're that testament, do we need to get a letter from you? Do I need a letter from you writing, if I go to another church, do I need a letter from you saying that I'm worth what I'm saying, that what I'm saying is true, that what I'm bringing has value? Do I need that letter of commendation? We get them a lot of times, letters of commendation, you know, for a job well done, for going above and beyond the call of duty. He's saying, do we need one of them from you in order to go and to preach and to save souls? Amen. And then I love his answer to it, because he asks a question. He says, but then he answers his own question, and he says, you are our epistle written in our hope, in our hearts, known and read by all men. Mr. Smith, Donald, good to see you on this morning. He says that you are the epistle. So what people see, people know that we have been teaching you. People know that we have been leading you. People know that we have been telling you about the gospel. And so what you do and what you say is a reflection on what we do. So no matter what you write about what we taught you, no matter what you write about our value or our worth, amen, people are going to judge our value or our worth by what you do. It says, clearly you are an epistle of Christ. An epistle is just a letter. An epistle is a letter. This is what Paul wrote to the different churches. He wrote epistles. He wrote letters to them about what the scriptures are. I'm talking about different things that he had taught them when he was with them, reminding them, amen, of the things that they ought to be doing. And it says, clearly you are an epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but by the Spirit of the living God. Amen. So it doesn't need to be written down on paper, because the Spirit is evident. The Spirit is evident in how you live your life, in what you say, and in what you do. And it says, the Spirit of the living God, not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of flesh, that is of the heart. Amen. Because the heart is where it's got to take place. Amen. We hear these things, we say these things, we process these things in our mind. But what does the word say? It says, I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. And that's what it's about. That being that living epistle, being that example to the people, being Christ came to life, means having that word written in your heart that you might not sin against God. That you might not sin against God, because here's the things we've got to do. It's not just about going to church on Sunday. It's not people just see you going to church on Sunday. It's not just you telling people that you went to Bible study on Wednesday night. Amen. It's not just about you telling people that you prayed, but it's about what you say and what you do before the people. Amen. That word, what you choose to say and what you choose to do, that is where it all comes from. And it says, what does it say in James chapter 2, verse 18? It says, you say you've got faith. But someone will say, you have your faith and I have works. Show me your faith without your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. So those things that we do matter. We show people our faith by what we do. Amen. If we claim to have faith in Jesus, if we claim to say that he's going to bring us through, that he's going to save us, that he's going to carry the day, amen. But then we run, amen, and we go out and we cheat somebody at work to make a couple extra dollars, then we have shown people what our faith really is. No matter what we say, we show people our faith by what we do. They say, what do they say? Actions speak louder than words. Amen. Actions speak louder than words. So we can go out and we can tell people that we've accepted Jesus. We can tell people we have faith in Jesus. But then if we fall apart and become in despair and become distraught, every time we stub our toe, amen. Every time that a bill we weren't expecting comes in, every time the car breaks down, if we fall apart, amen, then we have shown people our faith by our works. Amen. By the same token, when we profess Jesus, when we claim Jesus, amen, and they know that we're going through and they see how we hold up, if they see that we persevere, if they see that we don't have to go out, amen, and cheat somebody to get what we want, if they see that we don't have to go out and take a drink to numb the pain, that the Holy Ghost in us is going to numb the pain, amen, then we are showing our faith by what? By our works. So those things that we do, those things that you do on a day-to-day basis, they matter. And it's about consistency, amen. I think a lot of people, it seems like these days, it's like, I don't know if there's any baseball fans out there, but baseball these days, it seems like every batter that gets up there either wants to hit a home run or they end up striking out. Amen. That they might hit 50 home runs in a game, in a season, but and that's a record and that's great. And that's, but what if they're striking out every other time? Amen. Then they're not of value to the team. So it's not about going out and doing that one big thing, but it's about the steady consistency of living your life the right way, day in and day out. Amen. It's not about going out and delivering a great sermon. If you go out and deliver a great sermon and you inspire people and you stir their hearts and you move them to want to be closer to Christ, and then they see you at the bar the next day, amen, you've shown your faith by your work. So what you do matters, amen. And I think a lot of us know that what we do matters, but the thing is, we've got to realize too, it's not just about what we do either, but it's about what we say as well, amen. That the words that we choose are important. As I was telling you, the person that I knew at work who had that son who was sick, amen, the encouragement that I got, she didn't do something great. She didn't give me some blessing, amen, but it was just a simple word that she said that gave me encouragement, because she's going through something, amen. That's one of the things, man, I would always pray, if there's one thing that I pray I never have to go through is a sick child, amen, having to worry about losing one of my children. That's the one thing, man. I'm like, anything else I can conceive of, Baron, but that one, man, that's a tough one for me to take. So when I heard her say those words, and she said, you know, I prayed that he let him live. She said, but if it's your will, God, then who am I to question it? The encouragement that I got from that word was just amazing. It was incredible. And we see that the word of God, amen, that's why it's the word come to life, because it says, the word itself says that death and life are in the power of the tongue, amen. And those who produce, and from the produce of his lips he shall be filled, and those who love it will eat its fruit, amen. So we see that death and life are the power of the tongue. And death and life doesn't mean necessarily physical death and life, amen. Spiritual death and life is in the power of your tongue. Emotional death and life is in the power of your tongue. Relationship death and life is in the power of your tongue. Amen. How many relationships have been destroyed by the power of the tongue? How many people have been driven out of church by the power of the tongue? How many people have been brought into the church by the power of the tongue? How many relationships have been made stronger by the power of the tongue? Sometimes I tell you, it's not great things. It's not some of the things I think that touch my wife the most are just the things that I say. Amen. It's not that I bring her something, or it's not that I buy her something. It's not that I do some great thing for her, but it's just telling her how nice she looks one day. And she goes, boy, I love you. Amen. Why? Because that's what she needed to hear at the time. The power of life and death is in the tongue. What we say matters. What we say counts. What we say can either draw people in to the kingdom, or it can push people out of the kingdom. Amen. So we see the importance, amen, of walking and talking and being the living epistle. Amen. The impact that we can have on people's lives, amen, is incredible. Being able to save somebody's whole soul by what they see you do, by people see you and go, you know what, I got to find out more about this Jesus. There's no value that can be placed on that. Amen. And we need to understand as well, Bishop Barron, good to see you coming on this morning, sir. We're on early today. So we're looking at now. So we've looked at how important it is. Amen. As Bishop has said, it's good that he's on here, that what kind of Bible are you? Amen. And we need to understand not just the impact on the people around us, but there's an impact on us. Amen. When we aren't the Bible that we ought to be, when we lead people astray. Amen. But as we see here, there's a good side to it. When we do it right, there's a blessing. When we do it wrong, there is trouble down the road for you when you do it wrong. So we're going to look first at, we're going to look at what happens when we do it wrong. Amen. What happens when you do it wrong? What happens when you're out there, people know you're a Christian, and yet they see you cussing, they see you drinking, they see you getting high, they see you cheating on your wife? What is it? Sherry Taylor, good to see you on here this morning. The saints are up early today. And what happens though? I want to tell you that understand the consequences of your actions. Understand the consequences of what you say, not just for the people around you, but for you yourself. There are some consequences. Amen. So we see here, we're going to look at Matthew. We're going to look at chapter 18, and we're going to look at verses 6 through 9. Jesus warns of offenses. So when you aren't the Bible that people ought to see, what it says, whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were drowned in the depths of the sea. Amen. So it's better for you. Better for you, amen, that you have a millstone hung around your neck, be tossed over the side of the boat and sink to the bottom of the sea, than that you go out there claiming Jesus Christ and telling people that grace means I can do whatever I want and I got to get out of jail free card. It's better for you to have a millstone hung around your neck than to go out there and tell people that Jesus said something he didn't say. It's better for you to have a millstone hung around your neck and be drowned in the sea than that you go out there and do things and say things that are going to harm God's people. God does not like it when people harm his people. Amen. There are entire nations that have been wiped off the face of this planet. Why? For harming his people. Amen. And it says here, he goes on even further than that. Forget about just the millstone hung around the neck. He says, if your hand or your foot causes you to sin, cut it off and cast it from you. It is better for you to enter into life lame or maimed rather than having two hands or two feet and being cast into the everlasting fire. And if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you. It is better for you to enter into life with one eye rather than having two eyes and being cast into hellfire. That's right. Bishop said it many times. There's two things. There's heaven and there's hell. Amen. So you can't miss both. You cannot miss both. Amen. But by the same token, amen, God tells us, amen, that there is a blessing when we go out and we do his word and we walk his word and we live his word. Amen. He promises us. So if when we do wrong, amen, He tells us that when we do wrong, that it's better, amen, that we be drowned in the sea than that we go out and do wrong, that we lead another one astray, which isn't always dragging them to it, but just by setting the bad example before the people, we can lead them astray. Just by saying the wrong things before the people, we can lead them astray. But yet the word also tells us, amen, that for those who persevere, that those who persevere, there is a crown of life. Amen. You receive the crown of life. Amen. If you persevere, because we know we're all going to go through that things like that person at work I was telling you about. She was going through some things, but she receives the crown of life. Why? Because she persevered, because she carried through and she carried through and she carried herself in the right way as she was going through. So I know we're all going to go through some things in life. I know we're all going to have some times, amen, when our flesh, amen, doesn't want to be the Bible that everybody ought to be reading. There are going to be times when our flesh doesn't want to get up early, amen, and do a Bible study, amen. There's going to be times when our flesh doesn't want to get up early and pray. There's going to be times when we're out in public and someone's mistreating us, and we don't want to what? Turn the other cheek. We want to get vengeance right then and there, amen. But when we persevere, when we carry through in those situations, and the people see it, because the people are watching you, they see you getting mistreated at work, and they're watching how you react, amen. But when you persevere, you receive the crown of life, amen. That when you persevere, that when you're going through, when your flesh is starting to rise up, and that spirit in you is able to suppress it, and you're able to do the right thing, and you're able to say the right thing, you receive that crown of life, amen. And when I get up to heaven, man, I want to just have dozens of crowns that I can cast at Jesus' feet, amen, and say, here you go, sir, and I want to hear, well done, my good and faithful servant, amen. So I just want to encourage you today to think as you go through your day, who's around you and what are they seeing? How do people see Jesus when they see you? What do people think of Jesus when they see you? Are you drawing people into the kingdom, or are you chasing people away from the kingdom? Amen. So I just want to encourage you as you go out today, amen, remember that you are a living epistle. Amen. You are the Bible come to life. This word here, amen, that people aren't really reading much anymore, you are that Bible for them. So as you go through your day today, I want you to just think about what kind of scripture am I? What scripture am I demonstrating to the people? Amen. The Jesus said, love you. You've heard it said, love your friend and hate your enemy. Well, I'm telling you, love your enemy. Amen. And pray for those that despitefully use you. Amen. Are you doing that today? Is that what you're walking in today? We think about some of the scriptures and some of the parables that Jesus told. Are you being the good Samaritan today? Amen. Are you helping out that person? Amen. That you got no benefit from helping that person. And are you taking responsibility for them? Are you not just doing the bare minimum? What does the scripture say? If you're on your way to work today, it says, when you work as though working for the Lord. Amen. And not for man. Even when they're not watching you, you work as though you're working for the Lord. Are you doing that today? Ask yourself, am I living the very things that I'm reading? Am I living the very things that I claim my faith in? Amen. And if you're doing those things, if you can answer yes to that question at the end of the day, if you can answer yes to that question, then get ready for the crown, amen, of life that's waiting for you. So I pray, God, I thank God for you all being on here today. I'm praying for you. I hope that you're praying for me. I pray that you have a blessed day. I'm on my way now into the job. Amen. Why? Not just to do the job. Amen. But to try and lead some people to Christ while I'm there. I can't, you know, I'm working for a company. I can't go in and I can't stand in the lobby and preach, but my actions can preach. My words can preach. My actions can encourage somebody else, or they can drag somebody else down. So as I go to work today, I'm gonna give it my best, amen, to show people a living Christ that saved me, that made the difference in my life. God bless you all. I pray you all have a great day. God bless. Jesus loves you, and so do I.